Welcome to Hope Sabbath School, an in-depth, interactive study of the Word of God. I'm glad you joined us today because we're studying an amazing series from rebellion to redemption, the story of the great controversy between good and evil. We're learning not only that God wins, but that He wants us to be part of His victory. So I'm glad you joined us today as we talk about victory in the wilderness, where Emmanuel comes to our rescue. Yes. Welcome to Hope Sabbath School. Welcome to the team. Isn't this a great series?
Yes.
I felt a little bit overwhelmed at first because I felt like we're covering the whole Bible. And sometimes it seems, I guess we are, and sometimes it's like so much more you want to share, but I appreciate there's a pattern we see that obstacles come, the battle, the enemy's fighting, but God brings deliverance. Mm-hmm. We'll see that most clearly with Jesus in the wilderness in our study today. And we're glad that you join us. We have so many Hope Sabbath School members, we can't keep track of everyone, but when you write to us, it kind of gives us a better picture of who you are and what God's doing in your life. You can write to us at sshope@hopetv.org. And we share that with the entire team, and we're all encouraged. Here's one from Catherine in Botswana. You know where Botswana is, right? Botswana, right there in central part. You've got right. Zambia and Botswana. Gloria, you're from West Africa, right? She's smiling. Yeah. She's like, Derek, your geography's not really that great. But I know it's in the central part of Africa, Botswana. Greetings in the wonderful name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. She said, I thank Him. I'm able to communicate with you. Now get this. This is Catherine. We've never met Catherine. She lives in Botswana. But she says, you put a smile on my face every day.
Amen.
You activate my faith. You keep the light shining in me. You strengthen my faith. You brought me hope, not only for me, but for millions around the world. And I hope soon that I can meet with you. Amen?
Amen.
Well, I want to tell you, Catherine, if you can get here to where we film, we're just north of Washington, D.C., we would love to meet you in person. Otherwise, I suppose we could all come to Botswana and see you there. But we're glad you're part of our Hope Sabbath School family. Johnny writes from Kenya. We have a lot of Hope Sabbath School members in Kenya, don't we? We hear regularly from Kenya. He says, I'm blessed and moved by the teachings on Hope Sabbath School. Mm-hmm. May God open more revelation to you so that you can continue to be a blessing to many. Now, where does that revelation come from?
The Word of God.
You know, it comes from the Word of God, right? That's why we read the Scriptures and share together in an in-depth, interactive study of the Word of God. Now, this is from Roatan, Isla de Bahia. That's an island, right? Yes. Andrea's nodding like, I think I know where that is, right? Is that just off the coast of the northern part of South America?
Honduras. I think.
Okay, yeah. Near Honduras?
I think so.
Hi, my name's Gina. I live in Roatan, Isla de Bahia. She says, I love to hear the teaching about Jesus. Jesus is my everything.
Amen.
I like that. She says, please pray for me and my family that we can be strong in our daily walk with Jesus. Is that a good request?
It is.
Oh, my. I love Hope Channel. She says, you share the word with people around the world. And Gina, we're glad that you're one of those people. And you know, every person is precious to God. Mm. So we're not just in a numbers game, or how many million do we have? No. Each person is precious to God. And we're happy to hear from you in Roatan. And here's one from the United States of America. Justin writes, and he says, I like watching the Bible made so simple.
Mm. Amen. That's good.
I watch you on YouTube. Because I work most of the week, so either on late Friday evening or Saturday morning before going to church, I watch Hope Sabbath School. It is amazing to see how the Holy Spirit is working through everyone on the team. I post each YouTube video of Hope Sabbath School on my Facebook timeline.
Wow.
Some of you know what that means, right? We have more than what? I'm not supposed to tell you how many likes we have on Facebook. I'll just tell you, it's way over 100,000. Because if I tell you, by the time it broadcasts, it's out of date. But if you are a Facebook follower, go to Hope Sabbath School, click on like, and we all smile. Because we're glad you're part of our Hope Sabbath School family. And we are just happy to hear from you all. By the way, if you've missed any in this series, Rebellion and Redemption, go to our website, hopetv.org/hopeSS. You can watch the entire series. Didn't we read a letter recently from someone who downloaded 150 programs to watch them in the Namibian desert? You say, that is amazing. It's all free. You can download them. While you're there, check out the new theme song, I Will Praise You, O Lord, with My Whole Heart. You can download the MP3 file and the sheet music. Sing it in your Bible study group. You can even download the outline that we use in our class, and you can begin teaching a Hope Sabbath School in your local area. But I hope you've learned the song already, because we're going to sing it right now.
I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will tell all your marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will tell all your marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High.
Now I have to tell you, Gary, you were in Tokyo not long ago, and someone recognized you. But wouldn't it be amazing to go somewhere and hear someone singing our theme song?
That'd
say,
be awesome.
Wow, they've hidden that word in their hearts.
Yes.
3,000-year-old scripture song. Let's sing it together.
I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will tell of all your marvelous works. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High.
You know, I have to smile, because I'm just imagining when we all arrive at the kingdom of God,
yes,
that there's going to be a lot of Hope Sabbath School members singing, I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. And we're going to walk past David, the psalmist. And he's going to look and say, I recognize the words, because he wrote them under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Who wrote the tune? We say, you don't know about Hope Sabbath School? We talked about you all the time.
Yes.
King David and God's grace, that was in a previous study in this series, how God can work good even when we fail if we will run to Him, yes, right?
Amen.
And if there's anyone that modeled that constant dependence on God, it was Jesus, yes, when He came to planet Earth.
Yes.
We're going to study about the victory in the wilderness today. Yes. Emmanuel to the rescue.
Yes.
Let's pray the Holy Spirit will guide us in our study. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the scriptures. We wouldn't know much about you without this divine revelation. And the same Spirit who inspired the prophets to write preserved the scriptures, even though people tried to destroy the Bible, preserved it so that we have a testimony today. Thank you that your word is here. As we study about Jesus today, particularly the battle that happened in the wilderness, I pray that your Holy Spirit would open our eyes to not only see the victory that Jesus experienced, but the victory that we can experience in this great controversy as we trust wholly in God. This is our prayer and a blessing upon each one who studies with us today. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to start in Matthew chapter 1. We're talking about Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. I would like to ask someone to read Matthew chapter 1. Kyle, would you start a study today? Verses 20 through 23. Now, you may remember that Matthew's writing specifically to convince his Jewish brothers and sisters that Jesus is the Messiah. So it wouldn't surprise us that he'd quote from the Hebrew Scriptures. Mm. But he's got something really important to say in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 20 through 23.
I'll be reading from the New King James Version. And it says, but while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you, Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child, and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us.
Now, this is Joseph, and by the way, he needs an angel to talk to him because the lady he's betrothed to has just told him she's pregnant, right? So it's a pretty stressful time for him. He knows he is not the father of this child, but he receives divine revelation that this is the work of God. Now, that's an important theme we're hearing in this great controversy struggle, because when we don't know what to do, what do we need?
Go to God.
We need divine revelation, right? Yeah. We need God to reveal his truth to us. And so the message comes that he should take his wife and should marry her. Now, what do you learn about the mission of Jesus from this text? There's a couple of important things. Stephanie, something jump out at you. The mission of the one who's to come.
That he was going to be with us.
Okay.
Well with us.
Okay. There's two things. That's the second thing, isn't it? Yes. Because his name is Emmanuel, which means
God with us.
So he is going to be a revelation to us of what God is like. In fact, isn't there a word of Jesus, John 14:9, he says, if you have seen me, you've seen the Father. Yes. He didn't say, I am the Father, right? Mm-hmm. But you want to know a revelation of what the Father is like.
Yes.
Look at me. So he is a revelation of what God is like. But there's something else in that text about his mission. Wilbur?
Also the plan of salvation.
Sure. Yes. Yeah, you'll call his name?
Jesus.
Jesus.
Because he'll save the people from their sins.
Yeshua, right? It's like Joshua in the Old Testament. The Lord saves. Mm. The Lord saves.
Amen.
So his whole name. What's your assignment? Well, my name is the Lord saves. Right? So he's on a mission.
Yes.
The Lord saves. Let's look at another text that talks about his mission in Luke 4 and verse 18. Luke 4 and verse 18. And who has that for us? Jonathan? Luke 4:18. Jesus is actually quoting a prophecy. And let me just pause here again, because there are some critics of the Bible that say that prophecy in Isaiah has nothing, a virgin conceiving, has nothing to do with Jesus. That's something in the 8th century B.C. Well, Matthew says that's talking about Jesus under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So we can either choose to believe a critic or we can believe what God says through the prophet. And by the way, Jesus believed that the prophet spoke under inspiration of God too. Yeah. So it shouldn't surprise us that Jesus here in Luke chapter 4 in the synagogue in Nazareth would quote one of the prophets. This is now being fulfilled. And how does it read in verse 18?
Okay, I'm reading from the New International Version. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. Hmm.
So there's a lot of really important things he's going to do, all summed up in saving us from our sin, from the result of our sin, from the damage of sin, and ultimately from death. He's on a mission. Now, when does he, is he Messiah from the very beginning, or does he start being Messiah at a certain point? Kyle, is he Messiah the whole time, or?
He's always the Messiah.
He's always, thank God, I'm so glad you said that. Now, you know, people say, well, then somehow God choose. No, he's always the Messiah, right? Because he's always, what was his other name?
Emmanuel.
He's always Emmanuel,
always from the beginning.
Even when he's little, growing up.
Right.
But he does begin his ministry at a certain time.
Yes.
And let's take a look at that in Matthew chapter 3. And let's look at the struggle before we look at the revelation. Matthew 3, verses 7 through 12. Adrian, would you read that for us? Let's see about, there's actually a prophet that comes before Messiah. Hmm. Let's read in Matthew 3, beginning with verse 7.
All right, I'm reading from the New International Version. Jesus answered him, It is also written,
Do not put the Lord your God to the test.
Actually, Matthew 3. I think you may be in chapter 4.
Okay.
Chapter 3, verse 7.
Okay, yes.
Okay.
But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with the repentance. And do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children from Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance. But after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his right hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire."
So John the Baptist is really rebuking his generation. Mm-hmm. Satan, sometimes if he can't defeat us one way, he'll try to defeat us another way. And what has he done to the children of Israel that's kind of blinded their eyes to their need for the Messiah who's going to save them? What's he done? Anybody? Yes, Jonathan.
They're more confident in their own identity than in following and having God's.
So they think our salvation is based upon being part of the chosen, right?
Right. Right.
And he's like, no. You know, we need a Savior, don't we? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And enter the Savior now, Daisy, verses 13 through 17, while John the Baptist is boldly proclaiming and preaching. Let's see what happens.
I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. But John tried to talk him out of it. "I am the one who needs to be baptized by you," he said. "So why are you coming to me?" But Jesus said, "It should be done, for we must carry out all that God requires." So John agreed to baptize him. After his baptism, as Jesus came out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my dearly loved Son, who brings me great joy."
So there are several supernatural revelations at his baptism. And I don't just want to mention this, I want to talk about our lives too, because we need some kind of divine confirmation that God's calling us to. Mm-hmm. We're not the Messiah, but we are invited to join him in his work, right? Yes. So what are the supernatural signs for Jesus?
The Spirit anointing.
Okay, the Holy Spirit descending like a dove.
Right.
Yeah. What else?
The voice of God.
He hears the voice, right?
Yes.
So these are supernatural signs, maybe even just John's reaction.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, I need to be baptized by you. You know, that, because Jesus has sensed that God has called him to a special work. So he comes and he hears this confirmation that he is indeed Jesus who will come as Savior. Mm. Now let me ask you a question from your life. I know we're not Jesus, but we are invited to join God in his work in this great battle between good and evil. There are times when we just need to know that God is leading and that God has a purpose for us. And I want to give you an opportunity to share a time that God really showed that to you. Mm. And that's not to give honor to you. That's to give honor to God. That he said, "See, I am asking you to do this," you know? Anybody want to share? Ulrich?
My call to the ministry was quite unique. Before 2008, I never used to go to church. And
by the way, now you are actually a pastor, right? We've had you on Hope Sabbath School for many years, but so you're saying not that long ago you weren't even going to church.
Right. Mm-hmm. And in 2008, I joined the church, I got baptized, and, you know, there was this desire to do something better, but I didn't fully understood what I was actually to do. So I was praying and asking God just to show me his will. Let me know why you want me to come to church now at this point in my life. And I just kept praying day after day, reading my Bible and just saying, "Lord, let your will be done. Let your will be done." And about 3 to 4 months in, a person came at my church with a special message, but they spoke to my pastor at that time. And he came and whispered to me that the individual wanted to speak with me because they had a special message for me. He didn't know what the message was because the person didn't tell him, but they wanted to speak to me. And when the individual spoke to me, they said that, you know, from the time I stepped foot in the church that Sabbath, the Spirit of God impressed them with a message to speak to someone in this church. They just didn't know who. But once they came into the sanctuary, it's like a light was hovering above me that no one else could see. Mm. And the person was moved to present the message to me that the reason why I was brought into the church is that God wanted me to be part of his ministry.
Now, that's pretty dramatic testimony, but I noticed it took him 3 months. So what's the lesson there?
I mean,
waiting for it. Preparation.
Yeah. You know, so, well, I prayed once and nothing happened. Well, the Bible says, pray without ceasing, right? Yes. Continue earnestly in prayer. So the answer's on its way. Yes. Anybody else? I mean, that's kind of amazing, but I guess that's what you needed for God to turn you. Anybody have a time when God just really caught your attention? Andrea, I see you nodding.
I feel like it's happened a lot, but I was just thinking of my current job right now. I was job hunting for probably about 10 months after being overseas. And through a series of, I guess, just God's intervention, being the right place at the right time, and not just coincidence, but definitely God leading, I'm here working. So,
and tell us what you do, because you actually have quite an exciting mission assignment.
Yeah, I do. I work in the Office of Volunteer Ministries in the North American Division, so I get to help send out volunteer missionaries around the world.
So people say, I would like to volunteer a year or how much time,
right?
And you help with the coordination of that.
Yeah.
And so you're praying, looking for not just a work, but
a ministry, a calling,
ministry.
And that's what I felt in my heart, and that's why I didn't think I could ever get that, but yeah, God really made it happen. So it wasn't just a job, but it was definitely a calling.
Amen. Is that exciting?
Amen.
You know, I think it's really important for us to recognize, and it doesn't mean we're all going to be pastors. You're not a pastor, and you know, we're not all going to be full-time evangelists, let's say, though you are all here talking about Jesus, right? So I guess we all have a work to do.
Yes, indeed.
And the wonderful thing is, just as the Father says, I need to just catch my son's attention here. I think he wants to do that for all of us. Mm. We're not the Messiah, I know, but we're joining Jesus in his work, right?
Right.
Now, the story goes on in chapter 4 of Matthew, verses 1 through 3. Immediately after hearing these words of affirmation, Stephanie, would you read the first... Well, let's go. Just have the first verse, if you would. Matthew 4, verse 1, and then we'll read verses 2 and 3 in a moment.
All right. And this is from the King James Version. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil.
So I have a question for you. Does God lead us into temptation?
No.
No. The Bible says he tempts no one. All right?
Correct.
Now, he may allow trials to come to us.
Yes.
But he's led by the Spirit into the wilderness, and there he's going to be tempted.
Yes.
He goes there actually to pray and prepare for his mission, because he's about to launch his ministry, right? In the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember that? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Satan looks upon that and says, this is my chance. You know, he's fasting and praying in the wilderness. Now, I have a really important question to ask. Jesus has just said, here I am, Lord. He was called to baptism. The affirmation comes. And now this huge attack. What is Satan trying to accomplish?
He's trying to...
I mean, had he tempted Jesus, Jonathan, during his life, do you think? Jesus is 30 now.
Certainly. I mean, all of us are tempted. But it seems like at this point, he's in a situation where now he is stepping out as a new representative for God, and there's so much at stake at what that's going to look like, what methods he's going to use, who he's going to depend upon, who's going to get the glory. And so Lucifer's like, maybe I can twist this and get him somehow.
So there's this intense attack Now, we're going to talk about the specifics in just a minute. Kyle, what any thoughts again about what he's trying to do?
Oh, I know we're going to get there in a minute, but God had just told, the Father had just told his Son that you are my beloved Son, right. And now Satan's coming trying to get him to doubt his identity
sure,
in the
sure.
Father.
Yeah. Is Satan not trying to just stop him
yes.
dead in his
yes.
tracks?
Yes.
Yes.
You know, before anything is accomplished.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, again, I know we got to look at these three great tests, but has anyone experienced this in her life or his life that you decide, you know, I'm just going to give it all to God mm-hmm. and I'm going to just follow wherever God leads, and it seems like the battle gets more intense.
Mm-hmm.
Has anybody, Wilbur, talk to me about that.
Yeah, for me, it was shortly after I got baptized. You know, I was dedicated in ministry, and after that, everything went wrong with school, with friends. I couldn't focus, and everything just went bad. And I gave up. I was in music ministry. I gave that up. And
So for a while, Satan's attacks were effective.
Yeah. Yeah, they were. It was very serious, but it took a friend of mine to actually talk to me and say, you know what, it's nothing. Jesus had to go through that, and therefore this is something he overcame. And therefore, with the, you know, in God's name, you're definitely going to overcome, but don't give up. And that was what changed.
Thank God for that friend.
Yes.
Right. Anybody else experience that? Do you resonate with that at all, or do you think that's an exception? You know, I had a young lady talk to me one time. I was a pastor in Pennsylvania, and she started really seeking God. And her parents were just fierce in their opposition. She said, I don't understand this. She said, I would go out party, come in at any hour of the morning, doing all kinds of bad things. My parents were just like totally relaxed. Now I'm seeking God, and they're like fighting me. Well, her parents are not the enemy, are they?
That's true.
Who's the enemy?
Satan.
That's right. He starts, I've got to stop Wilbur. I've got to stop Susan. I've got to stop these people because I know that Satan doesn't know the future. God knows the end from the beginning. But he's got a pretty good brain. If he sees you yielding wholly to God, what's going to happen?
Things are going to happen.
You'll be saved.
God is going to do supernatural things in you and through you, right?
Amen.
So here's the strategy. Yeah. Satan says, I've got to stop this person. And Kyle, if you would read verses 2 and 3, because you alluded to Satan's strategy with this first temptation. Matthew 4, verses 2 and 3.
Sure. And I'm reading from New King James Version. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread.
Talk to me about the strategy here, because by the way, the adversary, he's called that old serpent, the devil and Satan.
Yes.
He's known the prophecies about Messiah coming, right?
Right.
And then he heard the angel singing, glory unto you is born this day in the city of David, right?
Yes.
Glory
yes.
to God in the highest. So he knows the Messiah's arrived, right?
Yes. Yeah.
In fact, how do we know that he knew that?
Herod tried to kill him.
That's right. He uses an evil person to try to kill Jesus when he's still a baby. Yeah. So he knows, and he's watching all of this. So he's thought through these major tests very carefully, hasn't he? This isn't just random, oh, I'm tempted to do this, that. What's his approach here?
He's trying to get Jesus to doubt the Father's word.
Yes.
And that if, that first word, that gives the clue, because he's trying to get him to say, to doubt that he's really the Son of God. And that's the same strategy he used from the very beginning, from the fall of our world, to doubt, to get us to doubt the Word of God.
I was thinking about that even in Eden, right?
Doubt
the Word.
Did God not
Gloria?
Say,
I think that he's trying to, just like he does with all of us, trying to correlate who he is with what he can do. So Jesus says, you are my children, you are my beloved children. But the devil tries to tell us that you have to be a certain standard or do something for you to be able to be called the Son of God.
So he's tempting him to prove,
himself
by not trusting fully in the Father,
exactly.
but by doing what? Taking things into his own hands. Boy, that sounds a lot like Adam and Eve, doesn't it?
Yes.
Especially Adam.
Yes.
That sounds a lot, and the scripture speaks of Jesus as the second Adam. You know, will I trust fully in God,
right,
or will I take things into my own hands? Mm. Yeah, Wilbert.
I think he was also using distraction because Jesus was praying. You know, he knew the task ahead of him. But Satan decided to distract him to focus on his human self. He was hungry. Mm-hmm. He needed something to eat. So,
yeah. And actually, after 40 days of fasting, I'm not an expert on this, but they tell me when the hunger pains come back after that long period, it's actually a sign that you're dying. Mm. You know, I know you miss breakfast and you say, I'm starving to death, but actually you're not. You know, you'll live, right? But actually, hunger pains go away, and when they come back, your organs are breaking down. You are dying.
Wow.
And so this is a critical moment. Will he trust fully in God? And, you know, why did he pray for 40 days? In fact, why was he there for 40 days fasting and praying?
Preparation, the work ahead.
Why that long? What?
To learn dependence on God.
What did Jesus say about why he did anything that he did?
He needed to depend on the Father.
He said, I don't do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Yeah. So for some significant reason, and there's a lot of things about 40 years in the wilderness, and I don't know all of those things. He's there. He's contemplating his mission, fasting and praying. Then this attack comes, questioning his identity. Mm. Now let me ask you this question. Have you ever been tempted?
Sure.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. You didn't have to think about that. But have you ever been tempted to turn rocks into loaves of bread?
No.
Anybody?
No.
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 I think I was tempted yesterday. I'm not going to ask you how Satan tempts you, because that's kind of personal, right? He knows your areas of weakness. Sure. Some it's to get angry. For some it's to look at the wrong things, mm-hmm, or to covet things. He knows our area of weakness, right?
Right.
I don't know any of us. I've never met a person who's been tempted to turn stones into bread.
Correct. Yeah.
So, Stephanie, talk to me about that. Why? What's the significance of that temptation? I know doubting his identity, but
the significance is that he could do it.
Yep.
We can't do it. So,
so
we're
Satan,
not
you're telling me that Satan is admitting, mm-hmm, even in the temptation, that
yes,
Jesus is more than just a ordinary man.
Wow. Yeah.
He is Emmanuel.
Yes. Mm.
God with us. Right?
Yes.
But he isn't going to take things into his own hands.
Mm.
He's going to trust fully in the Father.
Amen.
Yeah, hold it.
I find it interesting how Satan tempts us not always with things that are necessarily bad, but in the circumstance or situation where to do it would be not trusting God.
Right.
Yeah. Finding bread is not evil, right?
Right.
But let's look how Jesus responds in verse 4, Matthew 4. And verse 4, Andrea, would you read that for us? Matthew 4, verse 4. Jesus quotes from the book of Deuteronomy.
Mm-hmm.
And I love this verse. I mean, this is what Hope Sabbath School is all about, really.
Amen.
Yeah. Let's see what Jesus says.
Okay, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. But Jesus told them, "No, the scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God."
Amen. Amen.
You know, that's quoted from Deuteronomy, and the context is when they're complaining. Mm. You know, and we all have a choice to make. Will we believe the word of God or not?
Simple. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Mm-hmm. Now, if you bring that to our day, what is crucially important for us when we come into temptation?
The word of God is in our hearts.
Yeah.
That's why the scripture says, "Thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I will not sin against thee."
So the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, will bring that word to our
remembrance.
And Hope Sabbath School is all about getting that word in, right?
Yes, exactly.
And because that word is a defense against the enemy. Jesus says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word." But the battle is very real here. Could Jesus have failed that test?
Yes.
You know, I met a person one time, I'm sure was very sincere, actually a Christian, who said no, because Jesus is fully God, and God can't sin. So why is Satan tempting Jesus if he can't sin? And the answer is, he's fully God, but he's also
fully man.
Fully man. right? And he has to choose just like Adam, whether he'll trust fully in the Father or not, right? He's not drawing on his own power. Could he have fallen? Absolutely. He could have, but he chose to trust fully in his Father.
That's right.
And it just reminds me of the fact that I can rely on God, the Father, solely, nothing else but the Father's power, and that's what Jesus did, because if he had an unfair advantage, then all bets are off. That means there's no way I could live a life through Christ because there was an unfair advantage.
Well, in a sense, he's called that Holy One which is born, you know, will be called the Son of God. So I wouldn't want to say that he's not using his divinity, right? He is depending fully on the Father just like us. But he knew no sin. So even if today I say, well, I'm going to live perfect from here on, which is, by the way, going to be really challenging, I'll get proud about how perfect I am. And that's a sin, right? I cannot atone for all of my past sin. The devil came, as Scripture says, and found nothing in him. You know, he was without sin. He was spotless, right? Without spot or blemish. But he's tested in all points. Doesn't it say that in Scripture? In all points like we are, and yet without sin. Well, Satan loses because Jesus runs to the Word and runs to his Father and says, Father, you're going to have to handle this because I'm not going to live by that but by your Word. Satan comes with another temptation. Let's take a look at the second one in Matthew chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. And who will read that for us? Have a volunteer? Yes, Stephanie? Verses 4 through 7, Matthew 4. By the way, in Luke's gospel, they're in a different order, but I don't think that's really significant. It's recording the three temptations. Luke has, Matthew has 1, 2, 3. Luke has 1, 3, 2. But they're there. This one, second one, according to Matthew's account.
Starting at 4?
In verse 4, down through verse 7.
Okay. I'll be reading from...
Verse 5 through 7, right? We just read verse 4.
I'll be reading from the King James Version. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Verse 7. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.
Now, how has Satan's strategy changed? Kyle, has he still got the same doubting the mission?
Yes.
That's still there. Okay.
He's still trying to do that.
But something's changed, Adrian, here. What's different?
I think it's funny how he tried to do what Jesus did. He tried to quote the Bible like Jesus quoted the Bible. So it's the same strategy, but he tried to use the word against Jesus.
So he says, oh, you want to quote the Bible? I can do that. By the way, he doesn't quote that whole passage of making the Most High your hiding place, which is what Jesus is doing. He's saying, if you make the Most High your hiding place, you don't need to be afraid. It's not saying you can go sit out on the main road here and sing Jesus Loves Me and hope nothing hits you. We call that presumption, right? That's presuming upon the mercy of God. No, he's made the Lord his hiding place, but you're right. I'll quote a text, right? What else do you see in the strategy here? Still doubting his mission.
Not only if thou be the Son of God, it's like he's not just wanting Jesus to doubt who he is, but to doubt the Father's love, though, because he's quoting here. He's saying, he says he will give his angels charge over you. And they will hold you up, and you won't even get hurt lest you dash your foot against a stone. So he's not saying, if you are the Son of God, for Jesus to doubt who he is. But he's wanting Jesus to doubt the Father's word as well.
And so maybe force the Father to show his care?
Yes.
Yeah, rather than saying, Father, when you know I need the care... It's again taking things into his own hands, isn't it? Now, does anybody here like high buildings? You like heights? Anybody like to go up on high places? Okay, Kyle, you could like heights?
Yeah.
You've done what do they call it? Zip lines and stuff where you climb up the pole.
There's a limit.
There is a limit. Okay. but okay. So you like heights. So I've seen these zip lines. You know, you climb up. They have a safety harness, right?
Right.
But let's say you don't put the harness on and we go up to the top of this tall pole, right? And I'm there with you, and I say, Kyle, jump. No harness.
No harness.
No rope. Just jump off the pole. Tempted?
You got a net for me at the bottom?
No net.
No net. I don't know. That's a good question.
I'm just wondering here. My answer would be no. You're crazy. Okay? So why is this a great temptation for Jesus? I mean, it's like, well, okay, the stone's into bread. He's dying of hunger, right? And if he dies, he can't fulfill his mission. So you got to take things into your own hands. What's the thing about jumping off a high building? It's the high point of the temple. Why is that like, this is a really strong temptation. I'm going to have to really trust in God. Does anybody figure that one out? What do you think, Gary?
It's let's say I had a car that could go 200 miles an hour, right? And the speed limit is like 150. Hey, maybe I want to go that fast because I have the capability, the ability to do so. But like for us, my car only goes 40 miles an hour. No matter how much I try, I can't reach that limit. So there is no real temptation for me to do that because I'm not capable of doing it.
Well, we could all jump off of the high point of the temple, though. Mm-hmm. We can't turn stones into bread. So it's not, and it's not saying use your power. It's saying presume on God's mercy to send angels to protect you. But why is it a temptation, Andrea?
I'm not sure on this, but I'm just wondering if it was significant that it was the temple and not just like a high building or whatever.
Ah, so you're reading it, looking at the text carefully and saying, is there something about jumping? Because where is he going to land if he jumps off the high point of the temple? Right in the temple courts, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's pretty sensational entrance, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
What's going on here, Stephanie?
What comes to my mind is gravity is going to take me down.
Well, yeah, that's true.
But Jesus, really, he could have flown. Yeah. If the angels didn't come, he could have, you know.
He could have.
So.
But why the temple? I think Andrea's onto something here that would make this a temptation. Maybe something that Jesus had heard, you know, don't do it God's way, the Father's way, but do it the way the people expect. This would look really good. Anybody know anything about that?
I believe that there was, during those times, they were expecting some type of Messiah, hoping
sure.
for one, and there were sometimes expectations that he would come somehow from falling off the temple or jumping off the temple, I've heard, and so maybe that was a temptation to show you, prove you're the Messiah.
Yeah, of course, they were looking for a Messiah who would deliver them from the Romans, right? But come in the way that the people expect.
Yeah. That would have been a sign.
Oh, my, that would have been so impressive, wouldn't it? Wow. And that was a Jewish expectation. Yes. That somehow he would appear in the temple courts. You know, well, don't just appear. Why don't you just come floating right down with angels? Mm-hmm. I mean, so again, you know, okay, you can do the mission, but do it your way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
And what stark contrast do we see with Jesus in Gethsemane, where he's praying what?
Thy will.
Thy will. Not my
will.
But your will be done. It is written, Jesus says, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. One more temptation. By the way, that's not exactly correct, because he hounds him all of his life. Satan tempts Jesus his whole life, doesn't he? Trying to crush him, trying to have people don't throw him off the precipice there at Nazareth. So it's happening his whole life. But this is a very concentrated series of attacks. Mm-hmm. And let's look now. Holder, would you read for us verses 8 through 10 of Matthew 4?
I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you, if you will fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan, for it is written, You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve.
What's different here? Anybody? What's different? Daisy?
He just went to the point of what he really wanted from
you. Okay, you know who I am. Okay. You know who you are. So what's the temptation?
Worship.
Yeah. The temptation is you don't have to be the Lamb of God.
Suffering. Yeah.
You don't have to be the suffering servant.
Right.
You have to do is just bow down. And I'll give you the world. You came for the world, I'll give it to you. No. What's wrong with this picture? First of all, he's a liar, Wilbur says. He said it more politely. Wilbur said he doesn't own the world. That's true. He just, the earth is the Lord's. I mean, he may claim dominion walking to and fro. It doesn't belong to him.
Yeah,
it's also a lie because if Jesus had done that, would he have given Jesus the world?
No.
No way. That's absolutely no intention of doing that, right? But the temptation for Jesus then is what?
Not to suffer.
For the glory.
Yes.
I was going to say not to suffer and
turn from the suffering.
You don't have to go through all of it.
I mean, if it's possible,
yeah.
Right? Let this cup pass from me. Mm. When Jesus was not only being beaten, he was bearing the sin of the world.
Wow.
Deal with the sin problem. If it's possible, take this from me. Nevertheless,
not my will,
but your will be done. Satan says, you don't have to do that. Here's another way.
Yeah.
And Jesus responds, how?
Get away.
Worship the Lord. Him only you'll serve.
The powerful thing we're seeing here about these three temptations is that it's not only at the low point, the things that are weak about us, but he also attacked the things that are good, because he knew who Jesus was, what his mission was, and more than likely who he was eventually going to be. So he's saying, here, you're going to be this Messiah, you're going to be the king, you're going to run everything. Oh, great. But you know what? Look, you don't have to go through that. So it's there for a person now to look at and say, you know what? Okay. Oh, you're onto something. Okay, yeah, I am going to be that. And you're showing me a better way. Okay, let me go that way, because eventually I'm going to get it anyway. So
now Jesus, he did not know the future, right? In his humanity, he's fully dependent on the Father, because we know he couldn't see beyond the tomb, right?
Right, right.
So how does he know that the way Satan is offering is not the Father's way?
The word of God.
That's
right.
And
I was just going to say, just off of what he said, like, with us, Satan, so often, he tempts us to bow down to him. We may not think that he's tempting us to bow down to him, but he's tempting us to do it his way to gain what we think we want. And it's maybe it's the easy way out, or maybe it's money or power or influence, whatever it is that we cherish. And he tempts us to do that, but we've got to look to the Word of God and say, what is the way what would Jesus do here? You know, how would he respond to this temptation? And by God's grace, we can say we live not by bread alone, but by the Word of God.
Yes. And there is a pattern in all three temptations in terms of the response of Jesus, right?
Right.
What's the pattern?
Word of God.
The Word.
The Word of God.
Yeah. Do not tempt. Worship God. Each time, the scripture. And how does he know which scripture to quote? Holy Spirit helps him. Jonathan, you had a thought.
Yeah, just it's scary to me thinking about how easy it would have, how good it would have looked if he had followed, for instance, the last temptation and said, okay, let me compromise my way of doing what God has called me to. I mean, he could have still been, you know, this great evangelist, great whatever. And it just makes me think about our own lives, how much we can survive two temptations. We can do great things, and yet we compromise, and we still look like we're doing great things. We still whatever, but at our heart, we are not truly devoted to God. And so it's a sobering thing.
I'm thinking of the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus says in the end, people say, Lord, Lord, haven't we done all these things? And he says, I don't know who you are.
Mercy.
Have mercy.
That's really troubling. And I guess it reminds us that even after the first or second temptation, that the battle's not over.
That's right.
You know, it's a daily, ongoing dependence. But I love verse 11. I want someone to read verse 11 of Matthew chapter 4. Would you read that for us, Aunt Adrian? That's just such an encouraging word. And then I want you to respond to that in terms of your own journey.
All right, I'm reading from the New International Version. And the devil then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him.
Good news?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Now, I think Luke says he left him for a season because, you know, the controversy is not over, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it's like Satan is seriously damaged by the word of God.
It's like he's saying, okay, you win this round.
Yes.
I'll be back.
Yes, yes. But angels come and strengthen him. What do you hear there that's encouraging, Gloria?
It's really encouraging that for me, when I read verse 11, I see that God was watching everything. The angels were watching too. And sometimes when we go through certain things, temptations, we might feel like we're alone in it. Mm-hmm. But God is watching, and he's hoping that we make the right choice for him. And at the end of it, maybe we might not see beyond the temptation, but at the end of it, he comes through to really rejoice with us.
Amen. So are there some promises when we feel like we're under attack that can bring encouragement to us? Mm-hmm. Like Gloria said, we may not be able to see all the way through yet, but there's some promises that we could hold on to.
Yes.
I see you kind of turning in your Bible. You know, it is a wonderful thing. Sometimes people ask me, how do they know those different Bible texts? And the answer is, you have to read or listen on your MP3 player while you're exercising or learn scripture songs, or because there are promises that tell us that God is going to be with us even when we can't see our way through, right?
Yes.
Anybody want to share a promise, Daisy? One that's especially meaningful to you.
This is maybe a little bit different, but it's in Luke chapter 9, verse 24.
Okay. Give us a moment to find that. Luke chapter 9. And verse 24, it sounds like these are words of Jesus, right?
Yes, it is.
Luke chapter 9, you're saying this is an encouragement when you're going through that attack or challenge.
Yes, and the New Living Translation says, if you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And I like this because when we go through trials, we're usually thinking about ourselves, like, oh, I can't risk my life for this. But if we stand for God, he has promised in this passage that even if we die at this physical death right now, we still have eternal life waiting for us. But if you're trying to preserve this life that has no meaning right now until Jesus comes and judges and takes the faithful ones home, if we're looking beyond the now and we're looking to eternity, God has promised that if we're willing to sacrifice now, he has promised eternal life for us. We should not be afraid to
And that's an interesting thought, because Jesus, when he's fasted 40 days and he's actually dying of hunger, but he's still impressed by the Father, he needs to stay and continue earnestly in prayer. He chose to say, whatever your will is, Father, for my life, right? Mm-hmm. He could have said, well, hold on a minute, I've got to try to save my life. And actually lose it. It's an interesting text. Thanks for sharing that. Another one, Stephanie, encouraging.
1 Corinthians 10:13.
1 Corinthians. This is the Apostle Paul, right?
Yes.
1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. Again, we're looking for some encouragement. Like Jesus going through the trial of battle raging, there's some encouragement for us.
King James Version says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. And I think of that way of escape as what God did, or when the angels came down and ministered to Jesus. He upheld him, and Satan fled. And that we can have that way of escape. Whatever we run into, God will provide a way of escape that we can be our own.
You know, that raises a really important point about how we can and should resist the devil. Mm-hmm. And I want to look at that text. You may have another one, but James 4, verses 7 and 8. I just sense this is really important for our Hope Sabbath School team around the world. because you alluded to it there in your comment on that text. But let's read it together, and who'll read that for us? Andrea?
Sure.
In James 4, verses 7 and 8.
Okay. Reading out of the New Living Translation. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Mm-hmm. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world.
So we've got to choose God rather than divided loyalty. But the secret, people say, I'm trying to resist the devil.
By yourself.
How do you do that, according to the text?
You submit to God.
You submit to God and?
Humble.
And draw near to him, yes. Right? You humble yourself, draw near to God.
And he will draw near to you.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, that's exactly what happened in the wilderness, right?
Right.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. We choose to draw near to God.
Yes.
We may say, God, I'm under attack. I don't know how I'm going to resist this temptation, but I'm running to you.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
I'm going to draw near to you. Would you take care of Satan for me?
Amen.
Well, the evil angels are harassing me.
Yes. Praise God.
Maybe someone you're watching today and you say, I am being pounded by the enemy. My appeal to you is to run to God.
Yes.
You say, I don't know how to pray. Just cry out, God, save me.
Yes.
Ask him to draw near. As you draw near in faith, he is not hiding from you. He's waiting for you.
Amen.
And say, God, fight that battle. Amen. I choose to let you gain the victory in me and through me. And he will do that for you. The victory wasn't just for Jesus. It was for all of us. But he also wants to work a victory in us for the honor of his name. I want to pray that you'd experience that amazing victory in your life through the power of his name. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I just sense as someone watching the program today, feeling under attack, feeling pulled away from God, pulled towards sin and rebellion. But God, you've told us that we can resist the devil by drawing near to you, running to you and saying, God, we don't know what to do, but we're just calling out to you to save us.
Amen.
I pray that we would do that and we will experience the deliverance. We will experience the supernatural intervention, even that we read here in the story of Jesus. God, thank you for the miracles that you work, and may we give a testimony of praise to you as we see you work in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks for joining us for Hope Sabbath School. By the way, I want you to write to us if you see that miraculous intervention, because the miracle continues as we call out to God and go out now and share that good news with those around you.